Some of you know pretty much the story about this program, and it sort of goes along, I guess, with this history of what's happened to this festival, how it's been postponed and postponed. I was hoping to play this a couple years ago when I was playing this on a number of concerts for my sabbatical, and the whole connection of this whole program was to start with the theme and variations, which come actually from the sextet in B-flat. And then I was going to tie it together at the end with the entire sextet transcribed by Brahms for four hands. The secondary theme is also, of course, one of variations. Obviously, the first two works are variations. The first piece I just played for you was given to Clara by Brahms when she was 41 on her birthday, September 13th, 1860. Brahms was a very young, very virile, handsome 27-year-old. This piece, the sextet, and the variations to some degree were written at a time when Brahms was very much falling in love with a woman who he actually got engaged to. I'm not sure if many people know that. Her name was Agatha von Siebold. She was a singer that he met in 1858 through his friend Julius Grimm, and he started getting involved in these sort of women's choral festivals. He liked the ladies and he loved conducting these ladies, and he was always drawn to intelligent women, and Clara, of course, being one of the main ones. But Agatha was not only a usually good singer and talented musician, but she was very attractive. They met and they corresponded, and he met her again, and they got secretly engaged. However, Brahms, being the paradox that he was, and having many issues with his own life, not being sure of himself as a composer, that was his official excuse, he didn't feel he'd go back to her as with another failure to her and be the man he wanted to be. So he wrote her this letter, which really hurt her, but said he wanted to be with her anyway, just couldn't marry her. After they were engaged, and you didn't do that in 1859, 1860. So she wrote him a letter and returned the ring. There was a ring. And sadly, she sort of left this town in Göttingen where she was well known. She ran away. She almost had a nervous breakdown. And it was, in those days, that was a serious thing to break up with somebody and have your betrothal broken. So typical Brahms, he did nothing. Julius Grimm, his good friend who introduced them, didn't speak to Brahms for a year. Clara, around that time, had run into them when they were together in a little excursion. She brought her children. Grimm was there. Agatha were there. Other people were there. But somehow they were walking in this park, and Brahms snuck off with Agatha, and he was sort of embracing her in this little corner, and who comes around the corner but Clara? And she had feelings for him, so she immediately turned around, ran back, packed her bags, packed her children, and off she went. They didn't speak for some time. Brahms did, of course, nothing. He said nothing. Everybody usually came back to Brahms. That's how we sort of was used to it. He liked it that way, and it always worked out that way. But I think he really knew he'd screwed up in a lot of ways with his life. And my own theory is these variations that he gave to her. It was interesting. The sextet is a very Eulian and very warm work. It would sort of counter a lot of this darker, more serious first half. But it was a sort of a happy time of his life, maybe because of Agatha or who knows what. But I think he made this as sort of a peace offering. She was very happy to get it. She liked the piece. And transcriptions were very important in many people's homes, particularly the Schumann family. The girls would play transcriptions, Clara would play them, and she learned pieces that way often because they didn't have recordings. And so this piece was a very special piece, but it didn't go out of the family, and it was unknown until 30 years after Brahms died. It was published in 1927. And now it's become somewhat more known, and I've come to really love this piece, so I thought it would be a very nice start. The second piece, I don't have too much to say about that, fortunately, but it's one of the variations that I came to sort of late in life. It was something my teacher, Barry Snyder, taught a lot, but like some pieces by Brahms, it just didn't attract me somehow, and I think I was just that immature, I didn't really understand it. But it's a very interesting, complex piece of 11 variations. Typical chorale theme in the opening, like you would find in many works at that time. It's really a masterwork. I don't know why it's not played more. I think it's because it's a complex piece. You hear Handel variations or even sometimes Opus 9, the Clara variations more. Brahms was known to have played the 111, and I have a personal theory about that. The piece I could see would attract him. He loved Beethoven, and the last variations to me are maybe the most marvelous of all because if you just transform through the music, it's the most remarkable transition. And it has this very, very long, over two pages of pedal point trill, just this long extended trill. And somehow, I wonder if he didn't have that 111 a little bit in mind. He wasn't playing so many concerts by that point, but when he was young and practicing as an earlier pianist, he did play it, we're told. So this is the Variations in D major on original theme, Opus 21. Thank you. of the things that, there's so many things to think about that I forgot to mention, but it's been on my mind a lot, is, Barry Snyder. Many of you know him. In fact, I started to realize, I knew this before I got here, but today especially I realized this isn't just about Mannheimer, but it seems to be a Genhart reunion. When you put these two groups together, that's what it is. And Barry was doing a recital of his own, and so we decided that he could play the sextet. He can't be with us, but he's a little sick. Sorry, it's very hard. He's generally okay, but he has a condition that the doctor said he needed to stay there. It's a real shock to him, and those of you that know him may want to reach out to him. I have his number or his email, but he's watching tonight, so he's with us. You may have noticed in your program that I included a little text because I was reading an article in a magazine I don't always read, but this is one of the best ones I've ever read in that magazine. It's the AMT, and it's about the poetic, it's about the poetic text in Brahms' late Intermezzi. And this is the article. I highly recommend it. It's called The Forgotten Poetic Text. It's written by a young man I don't know, but his name is Archer Armstrong. And he's quite brilliant. The writing is superb, and he had some very good references, and I read all of them. And I learned things that I didn't really know about these Intermezzi. I sort of knew and sensed as I played these Opus 117 that they are, I think, for me, the most intimate and maybe the deeply most innig of all the ones he wrote at the end. One could argue about a few others, but I think as a set, they're pretty intense. He called them the sorrows of my tears, these lullabies. It could be possible because in 1892, when he was writing and working on some of these intermezzi, like the Opus 117, his daughter, his sister Elise died, and also Elisabeth van Herzogenberg, who was very, very close to him. And it could have been a reason why he said that. The first piece is a lullaby, and very naively, you know, I looked at the text like everyone else does. We all know this music in this room very, very well, but what I didn't know is the first two lines don't even give you a whiff of what this piece is about. Sleep softly, my child, sleep softly and beautifully. It troubles me to see you cry. That's nice, but it's not really a lullaby about children. It really deals with a woman who was scorned by a man. She had the child, he left her, and the text goes on. I'm just going to say a few of the verses. They'll give you an idea how this piece, I think, really was conceived by Brahms, as opposed to the text, but through the influence. Sleep softly, mother's little sweetheart, your father has hurt me bitterly. Later she writes, when your father stepped towards me and begged me so sweetly for my love, I neither saw his deceitful face nor his sweet falsehood. Now, unfortunately, I see it and I understand, this is the best part, how both of us, she's talking to the child in the cradle, how both of us mean nothing to him. She goes on to talk about, may God preserve you, though it hurts me, that you also carry his face in bearing. So in the child, she sees her husband. And at the very, very end, in the 12th strophe, it's the long one, farewell, therefore, false young man, and may he deceive maidens nevermore. Alas, I wish each maiden would learn from me that no man is true and protect herself. Only they capture our heart. Once they capture our heart, they feel no pain. Well, that's pretty intense, and it certainly made me rethink the first intermezzo in E-flat, you know, that wonderful, but very, very dark middle section, I think alludes very much to this poem. What I learned in other reading was, we always think of Brahms, of course, as the absolute music because of Hans Lick, and I never really quite bought it. I mean, he was a very literary man, and he found several texts that he put in music, but he didn't advertise it. But he was very cultured, and someone apparently sent him some anonymous poems, and when he was writing 118, I think there were six of them, he used these poems when he was playing them for his friends, and he would make copies and distribute them. So he actually put some significance to them. Sadly, all are lost, but one poem still exists of the great E-flat minor. So that one's there. There's also a poem, which I didn't sadly bring with me, I should have sent that to you along with this, but there's also a poem that Halbeck, Max Halbeck, the publisher, said goes to the third one, which for me is maybe one of the darkest of all of them. The last one is obviously the brighter one. It's a wonderful little 3/8 sort of waltz, but he's playing around so much with the hemiola, you don't know sometimes if you're in 3/4 or 6/8. It's just charming, and it's all over in less than 2 minutes. I was thinking about what John Perry said today. We were talking about pianos, and we've talked about pianos before, he and I have a very strong feeling about the pianos I like to play. Everyone does, but this piano here, I've pretty much dated it to be 1893, which is the exact date that the 117 was published. And it's a very, very different piano than many pianos. Its sustain is like no other. I just love playing it. And it has a sound that to me is much more suitable for this music, although the other piano is very fine too. So I thought you'd like to know it. It certainly doesn't look like a new instrument. So I hope you enjoy the four intermezzi.